Now then, so we're turning to GAA. This weekend, it is Kilkenny against Cork in the hurling. At the turn of the century, this was the defining rivalry in the sport. And honestly, I'm delighted to say we have these next two with us. I'm just kind of even delighted we're going to have these two talking to each other in the show. I'm not sure we've done it before. Tommy Walsh, you're there?
Yeah, how are you doing, Joe?
I'm very well. Say hello to Sean O'Gohalpine.
Hello, Sean. How are you keeping?
I'm fine, mate.
Yeah, not too bad, no.
I tell you what, about 15 years ago, we would have done well to get you two on the radio together.
We probably would have bought neither helmets, I'd say.
Tommy, you would have liked me, you know, you would have detested Tommy. Like, that's what it
is. Tommy likes everyone. So, Kilkenny, Cork, I mean, this was just such a phenomenal and interesting rivalry, and it's going to be great to get your thoughts on it. I mean, later in the week, we can look ahead to the specifics of the game. There were so many massive moments. Kilkenny going for three in a row, stopped by Cork in 04. Cork going for three in a row, stopped by Kilkenny in 06. And then all the off-the-field stuff as well. I'll read you a quote from Henry Shefflin, Tommy, and you can give me your sense of it, because this was one of those rivalries where you didn't like each other, and there was no bones about that. So Shefflin writes in his autobiography, let's just say that the red and white minstrel show that was the Cork team in the noughties never quite rocked our boat. They didn't like us and we didn't like them. Maybe we gave each other good reason. They depicted us as robotic, conformist types who couldn't locate an original thought of our own. Or, as Don Logue would famously put it, the Stepford Wives. We saw them as having a little too much of a welcome for themselves, of being aloof and standoffish and superior. He said, you think of the epic All-Irelands we had with Tip in more recent times, yet there was never any difficulty decommissioning the venom in the dressing room tunnel and unwinding together like grown men. Some of the most enjoyable nights I've had at All-Star functions have been in the company of those Tip players that we'd gone to war with the previous September. This never seemed possible with Cork. They radiated an attitude of preferring their own company.
Do I have to answer that one? I do.
I'll put that to you first.
Listen, Joe, you're talking back in the time. It was so intense. It was a massive, massive rivalry. First of all, I think to have a rivalry, both of you have to be at the top of your game. Mm. It can be kind of swinging one way where one team is always getting the better of the other. At that time, like, there were so many big names on both teams with huge personalities on the field and off the field. But on the field, like, if we can cover the on the field stuff, like when we went up against each other, like, there was no holds barred. Like, both of us thought we were the best. Both of us thought that we could get the better of the other team. Like, it goes back to, I suppose, 2003, I suppose, was our first meeting. So in that final, I suppose, there wasn't so much of a rivalry. But then it just built from there, because we won in 0-3 and then they stopped us doing the three in a row in 0-4. Mm. And I suppose when you have two teams that think they're the best, you're going to have a rivalry. And they're not going to like each other. There's no point in saying otherwise at that time. But, you know, like, I think it can only be healthy once it's, you know, like, Sean Og will agree with that. Like, I suppose since we finished hurling, you know, we all get on the finest. It was just at that time. You look at maybe Federer and Nadal, or you look at Liverpool and Man City, you know, Guardiola and Klopp. Like, I'm sure they're not the best of friends at the moment. But no. When the rivalry dies down, that's when you can get to meet each other.
Nobody is judging you here, Tommy. We think it was great at the time. There's no trouble there. In 04, so let's jump in there, seeing as you mentioned 04. This was Cork 17 points, Kilkenny 9 points. This was a really tense final. Interestingly, Sean Og, Shefflin talks about Cody sending him out to mark you that year, or you to mark him, whichever way it would transpire in the game in 04. You were headed for Hurler of the Year that year. What's your memory of that final, wanting to stop Kilkenny do the three in a row?
Well, funny enough, right, we were most confident going into that final, Joe. Despite losing the Munster final to Waterford, we knew if we got Kilkenny again, you know, that year, that the pain and anguish from the 2003 final would kind of give us the extra kick, you know what I mean, to get ready for it. And in that season, in the back of our minds, we knew, like, that if we were to win the All-Ireland Championship that year, it'd be worth nothing unless if we kind of met Kilkenny on the way. And as that happened, we got him in the final, right? So, I suppose, like, that game was tight for a lot of, you know, for a lot of the game, I suppose. we kind of finished off, state me here, Tommy, you know, it was just, like, you were ahead at half-time, right? As I can recall, no panic stations at half-time, right? Just stick to the process, stick to the routine. And in the second half then, what you call it, like, on the final stretch, we seemed to get probably 4 or 5 points in a row, which sealed the deal for us. If Kilkenny had got the 4 or 5 points in a row, it would have sealed the deal for them. We felt it was kind of, you know, retribution from the previous year. And I would concur with a lot of, like, sentiments that Tommy kind of spoke about the rivalry between Cork and Kilkenny back then. Look, both teams, players on each side, had to do whatever they had to do to win. Do you know what I mean? Like, whether that was on or off the field. And I would describe it like kind of the US and the USSR, you know, back then, kind of vying for the first fella to the moon. Do you know what I mean? Kind of whatever Kilkenny did better 1 year, Cork would have going to come the following year and then go an extra 10 years and vice versa, right?
So, and who was USSR?
I suppose Cork, having the Cork colours, yeah, and USSR red and white, kind of, because, and the reason why I say it is, like, ultimately, USA, like, kind of, got Neil Armstrong on the moon. Old rivalry, I mean, disappointed from a Cork point of view, that rivalry only realistically went to 2006. After that, it was a foregone conclusion. Yeah. Kenny just absolutely kind of did a Sugar Ray Leonard on it. Do you know what I mean? Beat Hagler, beat Hitman Hearns, beat what you call it, Roberto Duran. Do you know what I mean? Where we couldn't beat Azerbaijan after that. Let's be honest. But for that four or five years when we were going tit for tat, toe for toe, yeah, we felt that we could compete for them and have their measure. Do you know what I mean?
Can I get your thoughts, Sean Oak, on, you know, I read out the quote from Shefflin, and certainly the off-the-field stuff was a big part of this rivalry. It was one of the things that made it so compelling. And it certainly intensifies around the 2002 league final. And this was a time for younger listeners when the GPA, now very much established, was just trying to get off the ground. It was a radical thing. And the GPA had an EGM, and it was agreed there'd be a protest before that final between Cork and Kilkenny. And the protest would take the nature of shirts outside shorts
down, yeah,
and socks down, and there'd be a fine for the county boards as a result, and it would make a statement. Now, at the EGM, Andy Comerford, Charlie Carter, DJ Carey and Brian McAvoy of the Kilkenny contingent were there. So come the Friday before the final, DJ's injured, Carter, McAvoy not in the starting 15, so it's kind of Andy Comerford on his own trying to sell this to the Kilkenny team. Tommy, you can tell me in a minute if you were there or not, if you remember. So here's what Shefflin writes in his autobiography. He says, as Andy Comerford, Andy began outlining the plan to us. Brian Cody stepped into the dressing room. There was an edge to Cody that year. We'd been bullied by Galway out the previous summer, and that memory offended just about everything he held dear. He was going to right that wrong, and he made it clear no distractions could be countenanced. Talks about a few other bits. First things first, says Cody, there's no effing way we're having any hand act our part in this protest. Our job on Sunday is to win the game. I don't give an SH1T what anyone outside the camp is doing. Andy Comerford, says Shefflin, tried to hold his ground. No, we're going to do what we agreed. Not a chance, Andy, said Cody. And that pretty much put an end to it. No more discussion. We looked at our shoes, hoping Andy didn't keep following that bear into the woods. So, were you there, Tommy, for that?
No, I wasn't but I would know, but I didn't come in till after the Leinster final that year.
Right.
It was my first year out of minor, so I came in after the Leinster final. But I would know because I know the form of Cody. And, this all comes down to, I suppose, you're being led by your leaders, your management, your main players. So if I give you two different scenarios. So Brian Cody, you know, has achieved more in the game than almost any other manager in the GAA. And his kind of mantra always was hurling. Like, what you did outside it was grand, as long as your number one priority was the game, was performing on that Sunday. And if there was anything else going to take away from that, he had no time for it. So distractions like pulling your jersey outside, your togs, pulling your socks up, that's what had to be done on that day. And Brian just saw that as a distraction because that would bring unwanted media attention, would take away from the talk about the game, the ultimate number one focus. You always have to remember at that time, like, no one really know what way the GPA was going. Were they looking for pay for play? Were they looking for professionalism? And, you know, I know that definitely in Kilkenny there would be probably, as in most counties, I suppose, but definitely in our side of it, it's definitely... We don't want that. Like, you know, we love the game. And I'm not saying anyone else doesn't, but I can only speak from our own point of view. Mm. We felt our only priority was the game of hurling. Our only enjoyment was loving winning matches, loving playing well. And anything else that was going to take away from that had to be put aside.
Yeah.
So that's a background behind that probably talk in the dressing room.
No, I understand. Sean O, can I bring you in there? Because maybe Kilkenny players as well didn't realise just how serious things were getting with the Cork team and the county board and the strike that was, you know, brewing. But you, as a team, certainly looking at Donal Logue's book and different people's comments, you would have felt stung by that. That irked you. That was almost the beginning of a change in that rivalry with Kilkenny.
Yeah, I would say that would be true statement to say, Joe, that that was the start of a gripe with, you know, kind of not Kilkenny, I suppose, with the Kilkenny team, but not the guys individually. I know it's hard to demarry guys individually with a team because the team is made up of individuals, but definitely that did. That's why any comer for, you know, in our minds, would always be held up in high esteem. Do you know what I mean? Because it was a ballsy move by Andy. Like, I mean, you read it out. Do you know what I mean? Kind of, it came from the top. You're not allowed to, you know, there's no way you're doing that demonstration. But Andy continues to do it, right? So, and then, to be fair, not every Cork fella, like, there was more Cork fellas did it, right?
I think
there was,
seven Cork lads did it,
15,
I think.
13 of the 15 kind of made their protest, right? So, so it was bad enough losing, but when you reflect and, you know, where was agreed beforehand, like that stance we made into both sides, and it wasn't fully replicated on one side. Yeah, we felt a bit shortchanged, right? And then that would have been the start. Well, to be honest, no, that year was the start of many things, especially for the Cork camp, Joe, because I mean we went on our first strike that year, right? And then back then it was like, it was more to do with player welfare issues, you know, kind of, and maybe it was a perfect marriage at the time, Joe, you know, our struggles within the Cork camp, kind of, and our struggle against the county board, trying to get players to get, you know, standard stuff, like to compete, and this would probably come as a shock to a lot of people, because people would see Cork as one of the leading countries, you know what I mean, plenty of cash behind them, to support players and whatever they needed to, you know what I mean, to compete in the campaign. But that group of players back then didn't feel like that the county board were as supportive as they should have been, like, you know. And then on top of that, do you know what I mean? Like, kind of in parallel, you had the GPA trying to kind of, I suppose, survive and create his own existence, do you know what I mean, in the world. And it was just the perfect marriage between all struggles and what they were trying to do, right? But whether rightly or wrongly, Joe, our biggest gripe, say, with Kilkenny back then was that, absolutely, yeah, there's a game to be won, grand, do you know what I mean? I wouldn't criticise him or knock him from that, right? Can I? But we just felt like lack of the bigger picture, do you know what I mean? Kind of, or the lack of short size, do you know what I mean? Like, and the bigger picture, kind of, we just felt they didn't understand that at the time, do you know what I mean? So, because the years since then, do you know what I mean? The GPA kind of started to grow, flourish. I mean, players' welfare rights started becoming on the table, a discussion people benefited from, do you know what I mean? Like, and I'm sure, like, not alone Cork players, but Kilkenny players, other players, do you know what I mean? Kind of, if you would expand it out. And we were just looking for comrades, do you know what I mean? I suppose not on the pitch, but off the pitch for the bigger picture struggle. we just felt that it wasn't forthcoming from them at the time. Do you know what I mean? And then look, if that's the case, so that was the case.
Totally. And Tommy, would you think it's a fair assertion if people were to say, well, it looked certainly like the Kilkenny lads, their house was in order, their county board seemed to be treating them reasonably well, they were just focused on winning, they were looking after themselves, and to hell with the bigger picture. It seems like that was the attitude. And as Sean Oak says, like, it's fair enough in some ways. Is that kind of a fair representation of where you were in your heads?
Well, I suppose I can only speak about myself, where I was. And where I was absolutely selfish. Like, I didn't, you know, to put it straight, I didn't care about anyone else. Like, first and foremost, I cared about myself.
Yeah.
Absolutely, 100% ruthless, selfish, and call it what you wanted. I wanted to go out first and foremost and be the best player in training, on the field, in the matches. I didn't care about anything else, first of all. After that then came winning. After that came everything else. So me helping players in other counties, whether that was the weaker counties who didn't get, you know, who weren't probably on getting the same dinners after training that we were getting, that didn't come across my mind. And when it did, it didn't matter. I only wanted to go out and train. And because you take it, I had a training session next Wednesday. You're going to be marking Charlie Carter, DJ, Henry. That's all you wanted. Be ready for them by his next training. And then the match came up, and then you're playing Cork. You know, Sean Ogg, Niall McCarthy, Ben O'Connor. Like, there could be nothing else in your mind. That was the way I looked at.
Yeah.
And it was absolutely selfish. And it didn't help, I suppose, the players in the weaker counties, we'll say, who mightn't have been getting the expenses or the dinners. But that's the way. And if I was back again, I'd do the very same thing, you know.
Yeah, I suspect you would.
I get that, after 15 years of reflection, you know, when you return and when you move on and you look back at things, you know what I mean, kind of, you might look at them differently, but I get what Tommy's saying there, you know, kind of, even though that wouldn't be my kind of thought at the time, but I absolutely get it now, like, you know.
2004 and 2005, Sean O, Cork win two in a row, and then the shoe is on the other foot, as opposed to you lads stopping Kilkenny going for three in a row. Tommy, it's you and Kilkenny trying to stop Cork, like Cork going for three in a row. Shefflin, in his book, because I sort of had the book outside, so I was looking through it, you know, he says, like, by 2006, our preoccupation with Cork framed everything. Like, Cork was the obsession. They had 13 consecutive championship victories. We heard they were bringing Roy Keane in to give them motivational talks. All this kind of stuff. He says, I remember bristling at the 05 All-Stars, the way they stuck together in one side of the room. They were champions, the centre of attention. You'd be looking across thinking, who do they think we are? So the 06 final, Cork and Kilkenny again. Where were you in your heads come 06 when it came to stopping Cork, Tommy?
Yeah, well, I suppose there's more to it as well, and is the way we probably prepared for the game. So we were still, but like, nowadays it's different. Everyone is so professional, but back then, not so much. Our kind of, you know, really, I suppose, philosophy on the game was, you train that time, I think it was Tuesday, Wednesday, Friday, and probably a game Sunday. So you didn't do anything until them games, but you just made sure that you were like a savage for training Tuesday, savage for training Wednesday, and so on. So there was no gyms really as such. There was no diets. Like, I remember I was down in UCC, and I used to be in Jackie Lennox's chipper maybe 3 and 4 times a week. Chips,
stop.
Chicken burgers, yeah, half pink sauce. In 2005, which was a year after that, I was working on a building site inside in Kilkenny. And I used to go down, and I had a fry every single day.
Tommy.
Yeah, every
Did you not see
day.
The picture of Sean Ogg with his top off and the medicine ball and the abs, the size of monsters?
Yeah, but that's what was driving us mad. We were saying, we'll eat these fries and we'll beat them anyway. But we didn't beat them. They bet us. But, you know, and we slowly had to change our ways. But if you can think, that was the mindset that we had. That we played a game. It was kind of like, if you go back to the United team, the Paul McGraths, the Brian Robsons, like the Tony Adams, the Arsenal team, the hard-nosed Arsenal team, like, we were just ready for game day, ready for training day. But everything else didn't really matter as such, we thought.
Yeah.
Now, we changed, don't get me wrong, like, we had to adapt. But at that time, that's the way it was. So if you can think of it then, they were after beating us then for 2 years. So it was kind of like, it's us against them, different philosophies on how you prepare for the game. We felt we prepared right, they felt they prepared right. So you have just two top dogs coming at it. But 2006, like, I even remember in training, like, you'd be doing your own runs maybe in the winter. And you're just thinking of Cork players. You know, when you're struggling to make that last run, just think, you picture one of the Cork players and that drives you on and you get over the line maybe a second or two quicker.
Right.
That's how intense it was. And I'm sure Sean Aull, I'm sure he had the very same feelings about us, but it was brilliant looking back on it now. But by God, even thinking about it right now, it was intense and it was savage. And thank God we won that 0-6 final. I mightn't be here today talking to you.
What?
I know. And Joe, Tommy's absolutely right.
Yeah.
Your season wouldn't be a complete season unless, like, from a Cork perspective, unless if you beat Kilkenny en route to an All-Ireland final, you know. And I'd imagine back then it was probably the same, like, kind of in the eyes of, you know, a Kilkenny player or camp, you know, kind of. But, like, funny enough, Joe, like, that rivalry between Cork and Kilkenny, like, it goes way back, you know.
Sure, it's the rivalry in some ways.
That was just a continuation, do you know what I mean? When I was growing up, I went up to, you know, All-Ireland finals in the 90s there, you know, where, like, Kilkenny beat Cork, and then basically a decade earlier, Kilkenny would have beaten Cork in 82, 83, do you know what I mean? So, like, it's a remarkable rivalry, do you know what I mean, that goes back years. As I said, Joe, it was underpinned by who were the aristocrats. Was it the Rebels or was it the Kilkenny Cat? And just players, teams did whatever they needed to do to win, you know. But like that 2006 final was probably like a watershed moment. Well, like for both teams, because basically one team went million miles upwards and the other team just plunged down, like, you know. I'm referring to us plunging down after 2006, you know.
And why do you think that happened, Sean Oak? Like, why was it such a devastating blow that you couldn't come back again over the next 2-3 years?
There was probably, various kind of factors and combination, various factors and reasons for that. Again, like, we went into another dispute, row over that winter, which didn't help matters. But between the long and short of it, right, and I don't want to use, like, I don't want to come across as using the dispute as an excuse, like, it wasn't. The bottom line was Kilkenny were assembling, like, kind of, probably the greatest team of all time, do you know what I mean, at that stage. And then this was the difference between Cork and Kilkenny. Kilkenny were kind of, what you call it, so you had Tommy coming into his peak, JJ Delaney, Henry Shefflin, greatest players we'll probably never see again, do you know what I mean, in action, right? Probably might take another 50 years to see a cohort of players of that calibre again. But you had Richie Power, kind of Richie Hogan, TJ Reeves, do you know what I mean, coming up, Taggy Fogarty. We couldn't replicate that. And then the problem with us, Joe, is unfortunately players are depreciating assets. We thought that we were still the goods for another 5 or 6 years, do you know what I mean? But in reality, like, kind of, we were probably coming, do you know what I mean, towards the end of our career, and we didn't replenish all stocks for Kilkenny did, like, you know. And then the rest is history, really.
I know we've kept you longer than we said. If you have to run, but I just one last question or two, but feel free to run, Sean Oak, if you have to. Just on that 06 final, Tommy, this is my last quote from the Henry Shefflin book, you'll be relieved to hear. He said, and this was very interesting, because this is the kind of thing we'd be sitting here on Off the Ball on a Monday saying and actually not knowing the truth. So he said, the irony of the 06 final was that we were lauded afterwards for our tactical shrewdness. John Allen said he'd never seen a more tactical final, but he said we were so driven in that final, so hungry for the ball, so worked up, that we ended up doing the very thing we vowed we wouldn't do. Cork liked to draw you into the tackle and then release the ball quick to the man you had just left. We couldn't fall into that trap, we said. We'd stay with our men, avoiding the temptation to go rushing in. We forgot that plan the moment the ball was thrown in. He said there's a famous image of the day of Sean Oak surrounded by four Kilkenny men. The truth is we couldn't help ourselves. Anything in red that moved, we just wanted to bury.
Yeah, sir, listen, you couldn't really say it much better than that, really. Like, that was probably the way it was. It's like, Cork versus us in 0-4, you know, everything that moved you. Like, basically, what he's talking about at the time, Joe, was it's much like now you have a sweeper system versus, you know, a more traditional type game like Limerick.
Back then, you had Cork.
Yeah, and it was it wasn't just a possession game, but it was a running game.
Yeah.
The lads of Tom and Jerry, you know, it was funny at the time, Tom and Jerry, but Tom Kenny and Jerry O'Connor, they were the midfield boys. And like, I was in college with Tom Kenny, and I remember telling you before, like, we had to do a speed test. I think it was 30 metres, 40 metres, maybe 100 metres possibly. But they test your speeds. And he forgot his runners. He had to do it in his shoes. And it was all sports. It wasn't just hurling. We had hurling, Gaelic football, soccer, all the sports in UCC were doing this test. And Tom Kenny won all them sprints in his shoes against all other sports.
When you say his shoes, do you mean like his runners or his shoes? Like his nightclub shoes?
Like, say, AV8s. I think they're AV8s, brown ones he was wearing that day. The skinny little...
You just hate those guys, Tommy, don't you? Don't you just hate those guys that good at everything?
Yeah, you're fast enough for yourself, in fairness.
But yeah,
but, yeah, like, himself and Jerry used to just run with them.
Yeah, just add to that, Joe, like, Kenny brought, like, that final, yeah, they definitely brought a kamikaze, like, kind of intensity, do you know what I mean, like that. We hadn't experienced back then.
Right.
And then another thing that killed us that day and the downfall was we prided ourselves on restarts, you know, puck out, creating what you call a space for a runner to run in and go low to pop it in. But little did we know, like, what was the faithless that day. So what Kilkenny did was they went the line back. So their full forward line went in back of us. Their half-forward line went back and they just clogged up the running space. They clogged up the spaces that we wanted the runners to go into, Joe. And it's like everything. Possession is 9/10 of the law. So our game was based a lot on getting ball to hand in possession and we were starved that day. So right. Between lack of possession and just being confronted by Japanese World War II kamikaze pilots, like, that would do anything to win. That was a huge concoction for a downfall, unfortunately.
It's a pity in some ways it was the last final that those two sides played against each other because it was such a brilliant rivalry. There was the April 09 league game when Kilkenny beat Cork by 27 points in Nolan Park. Or as Jackie Tyrrell says, we didn't want to just beat Cork that day, we wanted to trample them into the ground like dirt. Which is, you know, again, the honest truth of how you two felt about each other. I presume you weren't you were gone at that stage, Sean Oak, were you? Or was that was off the back of another strike?
No, funny enough, Joe, I was still involved.
Right.
But I didn't, luckily enough for me, I didn't play in that game. I was injured. It was a league game and I think it was March or April.
April 09, yeah.
But again, like, marred by controversy off the pitch. It was the final one, thank God. It was the final dispute and probably the most bitter one of all time because Gerard McCarthy had to vacate his managerial role after that.
Yeah.
So we went up to Nolan Park and we got a nice present and then that would have added to old, say, disgust to the Kilkenny, you know, around then, you know, kind of probably comrades looking for help, do you know what I mean, like, for the bigger picture, but just didn't get it. And I get it now, you know, looking back on reflection, they had a game to win, like, they're like the All Blacks, whether it's Cork or whether it's Leitrim or whether it's like kind of Kazakhstan, they will beat you by, if they can beat you by 60 points, they'll do it, you know? And I see that with full clarity now, you know?
Yeah. No,
not back then, but I see my, they did it And then, that's all you could see in that.
Yeah. Tommy, looking back, final question, can you see why they were miffed at you? Because you've spoke very well earlier about saying, look, I wouldn't change a thing. I was worried about me. I was selfish. I needed to win. It was my time. Can you, looking back, see why the Cork lads were looking at you saying, here, help us out a bit, will you?
Ah, yeah, but you're listening. It didn't matter who it was. You just don't like your rivals, Joe. So if I was playing for Cork, it'd be the very same thing. Or that's just the way you have to be, like, you know.
Yeah.
They're your competitor, they're the guys you want to beat. So, yeah, if I was in that dressing room, I'd be thinking the very same thing about us.
Yeah. Listen, lads, thanks for coming on and talking about all that, because, you know, it's a bit tetchy in places, I know, but it's amazing to get you both on together on the radio looking back on it. And, look, that's the context. If there's any young fans going along to Croke Park this Sunday, that's kind of a glimpse of the rivalry. So we'll let you go. Tommy, thanks as always.
Thanks, lads.
And Sean Oak, thanks very much, Sean Oak.
Yeah, it's a fault of the road, Joe.
See you later.
Take care, Tommy.
Okay. Bye.